Welcome to the Church Online Campus. We are so glad you're joining us. If at any time during the message tonight you have a question or you'd like to connect with us, go ahead and join our live chat to the right of the screen. One of our online hosts will be more than happy to talk with you. For all the questions regarding our church and what we're all about, go ahead and visit welcometothechurch.com. Now here is tonight's message. Enjoy.
We are in week number 2 of a series that does not have a name. And we're kind of like that old 70s song. I went to the desert with a horse with no name. Remember that song? Anyway, you guys, I'm bald. I'm dating myself on that one. But we're in a series with no name. And it doesn't have a name. It just has an image. And the image, it's not really self-explanatory, but when you look at this image, there's something that you see. And for the most part, the idea is there is... This group of lights that are all together, but they're dim and they're not bright, they're not shining, they're not different from any of the others. But then there's this one light over here that's completely separate. It's different, and it is shining around a cluster of other lights that are not. And so in this series, the passage of Scripture that we are really focusing on is when Jesus says that you are the light of the world, you are a city set upon a hill, and you cannot hide. And men do not take a candle and then hide it under a bushel, but they let it shine before all of the people in the house. And the Bible says instead that they put it on a stand and it gives light to everyone in the house. And in the same way, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And so in this series, what we're asking ourselves is if we are as Christians, as Christ followers, different, if we are salt, if we are light, if we are a city set upon a hill, if we are supposed to be different but yet still impacting the world around us, what makes us different? What makes us different? It can't be the fact that we gather together. There's a lot of people that are gathering together today. It can't be the fact that we have a religious book. There's a lot of religions out there that have religious books. It can't be that we just pray to our God, because there's a lot of different things and religion and religious people that do those things. What is the thing that makes us different from the world around us? What is the thing that makes us shine? What is the thing that separates us but yet helps us impact those around us? And we believe that it's Jesus. It's Jesus. It's not just Jesus, but it's how we respond to Jesus. And it's three things. Number one is that we as Christ followers, like we talked about last week, we believe that Jesus actually is who he says he is. That separates us from the other cults. That separates us from other religions. That separates us maybe from Uncle Joey or Aunt Susie or whoever. We actually believe that Jesus is who he says he is. And we talked about that last week. But because we believe that Jesus is who he says he is, the second step now is we live as Jesus says to live. And because we live as Jesus says to live, ultimately we share Jesus with everyone that we meet. And we make disciples of anyone who decides to follow him. Those are the three things about Jesus and our response to him that make us different. And last week we talked about, as we just said, we talked about how that we believe that Jesus is who he says he is. This week we want to continue on and we want to talk about how that as Christ followers, we not only believe Jesus is who he says he is, but secondly is that we live as Jesus says to live. We don't live as Uncle So-and-so says to live, or as culture says to live, or the latest song by so-and-so says to live. We live as Jesus, our Lord, our Savior, not the liar, not a lunatic, Lord and Savior. We live as he says that we should live. And so today, that's the journey that we're going to be on. It's looking at how does Jesus say we, as his followers, are actually supposed to live. So here we go. Let's get into it. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 22, verses 35 through 40, it says this. Now what's going on here is before we read it, that Jesus is around a group of people, and there was a certain group of people, the religious leaders of that day, didn't really care for Jesus much, and they were trying continually to trip him up and to trick him. But by doing so, often they tripped themselves up, they tricked themselves, and they also gave Jesus a great opportunity to explain what the kingdom of God was actually about. And this is one of those times. In Matthew chapter 22, verse 35, it says this. It says, "And one of them, an expert of the law, tested him with this question, 'Teacher, which is the greatest commandment of the law?' And Jesus replied, 'Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment, and the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. All of the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments.'" Now, Jesus has this guy, an expert of the law, come up to him and say, "Jesus, which one out of all of the teachings of Moses, out of all the teachings of the prophets, out of all of the things that God has told us throughout oral history and written history, what is the greatest command? What's the thing that God really wants from us?" And he said this not with a pure heart. He said this to trip Jesus up. But again, it gave Jesus a great avenue now to really teach the truth. And in this, Jesus says, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second of these goes right along with it, and that's to love your neighbor as yourself. Now, in this, Jesus is saying that with all of the things that the prophets have said, but then also tagging himself in this with all of the things that Jesus has said about how we're supposed to live. And when you read the Gospels, I don't know how often you've read the Gospels, the stories of Jesus. Some of you read them all the time. Some of you maybe are pretty new to church and faith. But when you read the stories of Jesus and the words of Jesus, Jesus was pretty self-explanatory about what he wanted us to do. In Matthew 5, it's called the Sermon of the Mount. Jesus says things like, in the world, you've heard it said by a bunch of people that don't commit adultery. Don't say I do to your wife and then say I do in so many ways to someone else's wife. Don't commit adultery. That was funny. Come on, wake up now, guys. It's okay. I know it's early. The world says, this cluster of dimly lit lights says, listen, the standard is don't commit adultery. But I say don't even look lustfully upon a woman. The world says, Jesus says in Matthew 5, the world will tell you, don't murder an enemy. Don't kill someone. But I tell you, don't even think bad thoughts about someone. Jesus says, the world's going to tell you, listen, give to your friends. Be a giver to the people that you like and that like you. But I tell you, give even to your enemies. And so you see in Matthew 5 that Jesus is saying, this is what the world says, but my standard's separate. This is what the world does, but I do something even more detailed and more godly. And Jesus is saying in this passage here in Matthew 22 that all of these things, from not committing adultery to not looking lustful to not murdering an enemy to not even thinking ill of someone, that all of these laws, the Ten Commandments, all the commandments that God will ever give us, they're all hung off of. The foundation of them is these two laws. Love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. Because the truth of the matter is if we can get that right, if we can love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, we'll love our neighbor as ourself. If we love our neighbor as ourself, we probably won't kill our neighbor. Okay? If we love our neighbor as ourself, we probably won't sleep with his wife. If we love our neighbor as ourself, we'll give to him even if he's not that kind to us. And Jesus is saying that the foundation, the thing that I want you to do, how I want you to live is this. First and foremost, love your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. And if you do that, you'll also do the second, love your neighbor as yourself. It'll flow naturally out of that. Now, let's be honest here. Be honest, it's okay. Is who here you have heard that before? We should love the Lord our God with all of our heart, all our soul, all our mind, and all our strength. This is not a trick question. If you raise your hand, I'm not going to pull the rug out from under you and make fun of you. I promise. Raise your hand if you've heard that before. Raise your hand if you heard it before. Okay, pretty much everybody in the room. We've all heard this before. We all know this. But here's, Here's the rub in this whole conversation, and it's pretty much this way always with Jesus, is it's not so much about knowing it, it's understanding it enough to where we actually do it. And I'm not that smart. I'm from Midwest. I'm from Indiana. And you're just real simple folk out there in the middle of the country. And I'm just not the brightest bulb in the bunch, not the sharpest tool in the shed, all that stuff. But the thing that I've come to grips with my life is that if I don't understand something, I can't do it. If I don't really understand what it means to love the Lord my God with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, and all my strength, I can't do it if I don't understand it. And a lot of times, if we're really honest, when we gather on the weekend at church, which is always worth our time, it's always beneficial to us, many times we hear statements or we read statements in Scripture and we know that they're good, but we don't necessarily know what they mean and how we walk it out. And I think this is one of those things that is so important because, again, the Ten Commandments are hanging off of this. The Sermon on the Mount is hanging off of it. This is the thing that separates us from the world around us. As we believe Jesus is who he says he is, and then also we live as Jesus says to live. How did Jesus say to live? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. So if that's the case, we got to wrap our mind around this and really understand it so that we can do it, because this is what Jesus wants from us. So today what we want to do is we want to sit on that first law that Jesus talks about, that first command that he talks about, loving the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength, and break this down and really talk about what does it mean and how can we do it, all right? To do that, we're going to turn to Matthew chapter 13, verse 44. Matthew 13, 44. This is a very short passage, but it's a really power-packed passage with a lot of cool truths in it. And we're just going to kind of skim across the top, dig down a little bit, but not get into all the nuances of it. But here we go. In Matthew 13, 44, Jesus says this. He says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that is hidden in a field. And when a man found it, he hid it again. And then in his joy, he went and sold all that he had, and he bought that field." I'm going to read that one more time. "The kingdom of heaven, the things of God, the kingdom of God is like a treasure that is hidden in a field. And when a man found it, he hid it again, and then with his joy went and sold all that he had, and he bought the field." So what's happening here is there's this guy. We don't know how old he is. We don't know if he's rich. We don't know if he's poor. We don't know if he's religious or not religious. We don't know anything about this guy other than the fact this cat is walking down the road. And he's walking down the road, and all of a sudden, as he's walking down the road, he sees this really big field that happens to be for sale. So like many of us, when we see a house that's for sale or a piece of property that's for sale, we get a hold of the realtor, we start to look in the windows, if we know all that type of stuff, and he starts investigating this piece of property. And as he's walking around the property, he's looking at trees and he's looking at the acreage and he sees what they're asking for it, and he's looking around, and as he's looking around, he sees this treasure that is buried up under, maybe I don't really know how it's buried, but it's buried up under something to where it's hidden under some brush or maybe in a deep hole or a pit. And he sees this treasure that's inside of this field. And so he looks at it and he realizes that's a lot of gold. That's a lot of coin. That's a lot of stuff. This is incredible. So he hides it again. And then he leaves and he goes to his house. And as he goes to his house, he begins to calculate in his mind, how much does the piece of property cost with the treasure hidden in it, and how much money do I have? And he starts to realize, I don't have enough money. I do have this pair of shoes. I could sell them. And I've got a closet full of clothes. I could sell them. And he says to his wife, garage sale. And he does this garage sale. He puts some stuff up on eBay. And he starts to realize, okay, I've sold my furniture. I've sold my clothes. I've sold everything in my house except for my kids. I thought about putting them on the market, but they're not worth much. And so I'm not going to sell them. But I've sold everything in my house. And he starts to tally it up. We'll just make a number. They're asking $100,000 for this piece of property. And I've only got $50,000. I sold everything but my house. And then he thinks to himself, if I sell my house, I'll have enough to buy the field with the treasure in it. So he puts his house up on the market. And he sells his house. He sells his clothes. He sells his shoes. He sells his furniture. Scripture says that he sells all that he has. And after he sells all that he has, he goes and he purchases this piece of property with the treasure in it. Now, this is a great example of what it means to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your, to love God with everything. This is a guy who, once he saw the piece of property with the hidden treasure in it, he realized how valuable it was, how precious it was, how incredibly unique this piece of property is with the buried treasure in it, that he became completely and utterly ate up with the piece of property. He's going home thinking about the property. He's selling shoes thinking about the property. He's putting us up on eBay thinking about the property. He says, this piece of property versus my house, I'd rather have the piece of property. This guy is completely ate up in his heart, in his mind, in his soul, in his strength, with all of his possessions. Everything is all about this piece of property. He's ate up with it. Now, some of the modern ways to kind of talk about this is have you ever known someone that was in love? Husbands, that's a great time to say, yes, it's me. It's still me. I'm madly in love with my woman. Have you ever known someone or seen someone that's in love? When someone falls in love, you know it because things begin to change. They change drastically. When someone is not in love, and then all of a sudden they see this, a guy is not in love, and all of a sudden he sees this female, and he's like, man, hubba hubba, come on to bubba. He begins to ate up with her, and his everything changes. His countenance changes. You see him kind of just, you know he's in love because you see him just kind of staring off into space and looking through a window, and he's just kind of looking there, gazing and thinking about, I'm in love, and I don't care who knows it, right? His countenance changes when someone's in love. When someone's truly in love, they go from having 10 interests to one interest. And they're totally ate up and infatuated with this person. They think about the person. They talk about the person. They dream about the person. They sell all of their other, they don't even listen to the same music anymore. And they go to the thrift store and they buy this CD from Michael Bolton. And they just... You know, they're in love, right? When you get in the car and you're listening to Michael Bolton, you know this cat's got it bad, right? He's in love. And he's totally and utterly ate up in his heart, in his mind, in his soul, in his pocketbook. It's about this girl that he loves. But, you know, I'm sure that's how it is with you guys in the room as well that are married. That's how it is with me when the first time I met Veronica, I've said it before, she came walking in with the pink dress, black polka dots on it, and whoo, hello. And I saw her walking in, and I start to talk with her, and then we go out on a date, and it's after that first date, I'm like, there is a God. And he created her, and I think he created her for me. And all of a sudden, everything changed. Where I used to really be into basketball, and I used to really be into hanging out with my friends, now I'm like, where I was in life at that time, I'm 18 years old, just graduated high school, and I'm I drive from Napanee, Indiana, all the way to South Bend, Indiana, which is a 45-minute drive to go to school for half a day. Then I drive to Elkhart, Indiana, which is another 30 minutes from South Bend to work for a half a day. And then I drive all the way back home, 30 minutes to Napanee. I eat dinner with my family, and then I drive about 35 minutes south to a little tiny town named Mentone, Indiana, about 12 people in it. But one of the people in the town sitting at a convenience store working late hours into the night was this girl, Veronica Hunsberger. So every single day, my friends would say, hey, Kev, we're going to the AC to play some ball. You want to come? Nope, I'm going to Mentone. And I would drive from Napanee to South Bend, from South Bend to Elkhart, from Elkhart to Napanee, to Napanee, to Mentone. And I would sit there in this convenience store, and Veronica would work on homework, and we'd just sit there and talk until the store closed at about 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock at night, and then I would drive all the way back home, and then I would do the whole thing again. Why? I made up with her. I got to hang out with her. And when it came to Veronica, play basketball with my buddies, hang out with Veronica. Veronica wins. Stay home and watch reruns of Knight Rider, because that was what was going on back in that time. Reruns of Knight Rider, or go hang out with Veronica in Mentone. Let's get in the car. I'm going to Mentone. And at that time in my life, I was absolutely mind and soul and body and everything. I love this girl. And even today, it's like go on a road trip with you or go on a road trip with Veronica. I'm going on a road trip with Veronica. Go out to eat with you, go out to eat with Veronica. I'm going out with Veronica. I'd rather fight with Veronica than you, okay? Anything, it doesn't matter what it is, Veronica wins. She always wins. Why? Because I love her. Now, here's the deal. I love you too, but I don't love you with all my heart, and I don't love you with all my soul, and I don't love you with all my mind, and I don't love you with all my strength. That's how I love her. And so because of that, she always wins. Not because she has to or she's demanding it from me. Boy, don't you know who I am? She's not like that. Not because she's demanding it from me. It's because I love her. I realize how precious she is. The treasure that she is. And I, heart, soul, mind, that's like this guy in the field. He's ate up with the field. He's got to have the field. Hey, have a pair of shoes or have the field. I'm going to sell the shoes and get the field. Have a house or have the field. I'm going to sell the house and get the field. This guy's ate up with the field. That's how it is when someone loves something with all their heart, with all their soul, with all their mind, and with all their strength. And that's what Jesus calls us to. That's what Jesus calls us to as it comes to us as believers. To not just love him, but to love him with all of our heart. To love him with all of our soul, with all of our mind, with all of our strength. That when it comes to our life, that I could have this, if it came to a choice, and sometimes it does, I could have this or I could have Jesus and the kingdom of God. Jesus wins. I can tell a half truth and save my butt, or I can be completely honest and honor my God. I'm going to honor my God and tell the complete truth. I could hang out with this person and do X, Y, and Z and dishonor my relationship that I have with my Heavenly Father, or I could do what my Heavenly Father wants me to do, and even if it makes this person mad and it hurts their feelings that I'm not going to do X, Y, and Z with them, I'm going to choose Jesus. I can hang with them or I can have Jesus, Jesus. I can look at porn or I can have Jesus, Jesus. I can think wicked thoughts about my neighbor and call them names in my mind and think ill against them, or I can live an honorable life with my God and Jesus. I can gossip or I can have Jesus. This is what it means, is when given the option, when given the option of this or this. Now, sometimes with Jesus, you can have a lot of things. God is big and gracious and kind, and he gives us a lot of things to enjoy. But if there's a choice between hanging out and playing basketball with the fellas or driving 45 minutes and sitting at a convenience store with Veronica, I'm getting in the car. Why? Love her with all my heart, soul, mind, spirit, strength. Love her with everything inside of me. And if there comes a time in our life where we can choose to have this or him, I choose him. Every time. Every time. And that's what separates us. That's this image. That's what separates us from the rest of the world. Because the rest of the world, yeah, I love God. And yes, I believe in God. But give him everything? You're crazy. Give him everything? Submit everything, the deepest, darkest crevices of my heart and my soul, my hands and my eyes and my body and my pocketbook. I mean, I'll do the hand thing and the eye thing, but man, don't mess with, you know, the back pocket area. Don't go there, God. You see, the rest of the world around us believes Jesus is good and Jesus is moral, but they don't believe he's Lord. We believe he's Lord. And because he is Lord, that has a ramification on every part of my life, on every part of our life. I just don't believe that Veronica's a really pretty lady. She's my wife. That changes how I interact with her and how I interact with others. It's the same way with Jesus. We as Christ followers don't believe that Jesus is just good. We believe that he is God. So because of that, that changes the way we interact with him, and that pulls us apart from the world because they don't think that of him. We do. Now, the thing that we got to understand is that this scares people. And it scares you, maybe. I'll be honest, it scared me at first. Not with Veronica, but with the Jesus stuff. Is sometimes when we think about Jesus and this idea of, man, he'll forgive me of my sins and he'll take me to heaven. Hey, he'll bless me. Hello, I'm in. I'll do that. But when it comes to this idea of loving him with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, all our giving him everything, there's a wall sometimes that goes up because we think the price is too high. He's just asking way too much for what I'm going to get in return. And when we start thinking about, I'll give him this, but not this. I'll give him that, but not that. Because if I give him this compared to what I'm getting back in return, it's not a good deal for me. And we think that we might in some way, shape, or form pay too much money, pay too much relationship, we might give more than what we're actually going to get back. And so that keeps us from separating from the pack all the way and living exactly as Christ says to live with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. And then all the ramifications that come with that because we think we won't get back as much as what we've given. But let's look again. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these other things will be added to you. And if you remember in the story of Matthew 13, if you can put the passage back up of Matthew 13, I believe it's 44. It says there that the kingdom of heaven is like a treasure that's hidden in a field. And when a man found it, he hid it again. And then with all of his joy, he went and sold all that he had and he bought the field. So this is a situation where a guy has a house and he has clothes and he has money in the bank account. He has his own thing going. And then he finds this field with a treasure in it. And what he saw about the field wasn't so attractive. The thing that he saw that attracted him was the treasure that was hidden inside of it. And he started to calculate, if I sell everything I have, okay, if I sell everything I have $100,000 of total net worth, let's say. Let's make up a number. I have $100,000 of total net worth. But I've done the calculating and the treasure that's hidden in the field. The field's worth $100,000, but the treasure's worth $1,000,000. So if I sell everything I have, $100,000, to spend $100,000 on the field, when I buy the field, I also get the treasure. And when I get the treasure, I get 10 times back that which I gave. And he thinks to himself, $100,000 investment, $1 million in return. That's a pretty good deal for daddy. Sold. And he sells everything to buy this. And what we see there is the kingdom of heaven is like this treasure that's hidden in a field. It's worth more than what you will ever sell. It is worth more than anything you have. And this man knew that. He knew that if I sell everything, if I give everything to have this treasure, I will get more in return than what I gave. And that's the point of one of the points of this passage is Jesus is letting us know that when we love God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength on our job and our finances and our parenting skills and our mindsets and what we put our hands to, when we love Jesus with everything, we get the kingdom of God. And when we get the kingdom of God, we get the treasure. And the treasure is not more money, a bigger house, and other temporal things that will soon pass away and we won't even like and they'll be out of style anymore. I mean, good night. Look at the pictures of yourself in high school, right? I mean, you're like, dude, you know, all dressed up, and I spent $60 on this shirt, and now you look at it, and you're like, ah, it's horrible. When we get the kingdom of God, we don't get other material things that are going to pass away. What we get is we get the treasure. We get Jesus. And who is Jesus? He's God who came down from heaven. He lived a perfect life. He can forgive you of all your sins and take you back up to the God in which created you. That's better than anything you have in your bank account right now. That's better than any clothes that you have or any car that you drive or any hidden sin that you have or any hidden thought that you have or that angst that you have against your brother. Jesus is better. And we as Christians, we know that. So what we do is we say, Jesus, I know you are who you say you are, so I will love you with all my heart, all my soul, all my mind, all my strength. And we get this treasure of Jesus in us, which all of a sudden brightens us up from the inside out. And we are different from everyone else around us. Not because we're better, because he's better. And this is what it means to be Christian, is when you love, when you know who Jesus is, we are willing to give him everything. Everything. Now, the question today is not do we know this? Again, I'm not saying things we don't probably be coming to church. I'm saying things we don't know. The question is have we done this? Have we done this? And listen, don't worry. I'm not getting ready to take up a big old offering. Hey, it's worth everything in your bank accounts. Write a check. I'm not talking about money. Jesus is talking about this. He's talking about this, our heart. The most valuable thing that you, your heart. And here's the thing that I found out in my life. Is years ago, I gave Jesus everything. I gave him everything. And I've gotten so much more back in return than what I've given him, that's for sure. This is a good deal. So today the question in closing is this, is have you done this as the band gets ready to come back up? Are you doing this now? Each day when you are forced to make a decision of this or pleasing Jesus, do you say, man, I want to please Jesus? Because when we love him with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, and all of our strength, that's what we do. And here's the other thing that I've learned is to give Jesus everything, it doesn't just happen overnight. It's a continual daily doing this. Of dying to ourself and dying to what the world thinks and letting Christ shine through us. It's like when you're married. It's not that Things aren't good in your marriage because years ago you said I do. Things are good in your marriage today because this morning when you got up, you said, I do. And then tomorrow you'll get up and you'll say, I still do. Then the next day, I do. And it's the same way in our relationship with Jesus. Things aren't great with you and Jesus, and you're not shining bright for Jesus simply because back in 1972 you said a prayer. And you said, Jesus, I do believe you are who you say you are, so I'll live as you say to live. That it's not good today simply because you said that back in the day. It's good today because when you woke up, you said, Jesus, I know who you are, so I will live as you say to live. And then the next day, Jesus, I know who you are, so I will live as you say to live. And it's a day by day surrender, and a day by day, Jesus getting brighter and brighter and brighter in every area of our life. And so today, for those of you that are walking with Jesus and you love Jesus, I'm just asking you a very simple but deep, maybe the most profound question of your life is, have you or are you so in love with Jesus that you love him with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength? And if the answer is yes, then keep on going. If the answer's been, I know him, but man, I'm going back and forth and I'm going back and forth. The thing of it is man, you're cheating yourself out of peace and joy and love and contentment and passion and purity that can never be found over here in anything of this world. Let the world go and grab a hold of who he actually is and let him do what only he can do in your life. Jesus wants us to be different. Jesus wants us to shine. Jesus wants us to impact the world around us. And the only way we can do that is if we love him enough to live as he says to live. I honestly today, at the end of this, I was in my office even this morning thinking, okay, man, okay, that's great. And maybe, hopefully, we broke down that passage good enough. But I always like to turn a corner and say, okay, here's two ways you can apply this. I'll just be honest with you. I don't know that I can't do that for you. Man, I tried all week, and especially this morning again, going back and wrestling with it. I don't know what you need to change to love him with all your heart, all your soul, and mind. I don't know what you theoretically in your heart need to sell. I don't know what that looks like, but I think you do. And I'm just telling you today, from reading the text and seeing other people's lives, but looking in the mirror and seeing my own life, I'm telling you, he is worth everything in your heart. He is worth it all. You will get so much more back than what you will give. And I don't know how each of you walk this out. But I do know what it looks like. Ate up with Jesus. Passionate about Jesus. I can have this or Jesus. There's no choice. I'm sticking with the man. Because I know who he is. So today, let's bow our heads and let's just ask God to wrestle with our heart of what this actually looks like, of how we apply this in our individual lives. Heavenly Father, we come to you today in Jesus' name, and we ask you, Lord, that you would take this very simple statement but deep statement of loving the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and loving you as ourself, and loving others as ourself, that we would wrestle with this today and ask ourselves this: Have I given up everything I have to have this treasure that's hidden in the kingdom of God? And God, if we haven't, I pray, God, that you would help us to take stock and inventory of our life to see what is left. Because the ultimate thing about Jesus is it cost us everything we have. Salvation is free, but walking with you and shining with you cost us everything that we have. But Lord, I thank you that if we do that and we take inventory and we take stock to say, what is it going to take to really know Jesus, to really have that peace and joy and love and strength that comes even in tough, tumultuous times because I've got this treasure? What is it going to cost me that, God, that we would take stock and realize he's worth it? And I don't know how we apply this to our lives today. I just don't in individual ways. But God, I pray that your spirit would wrestle with our heart and that we would weigh ourselves in the balance and realize Jesus is worth it. He is who he says he is. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks again for joining us at the Church Online. If you'd like to give towards the church, go ahead and press the Give button at the top of the screen. For all other questions, comments, or prayer requests, email us at info@welcomethechurch.com. Have a great week.